a neutralization reaction in which an acid and base react to form salt and water. I will repeat it. Acid-base titration involves neutralization reaction between an acid and a base to form salt and water. This is a very, very important part of pharmaceutical analysis because it helps us to tell us about the quality of the pharmaceutical products involved. Okay, so for understanding this, I will be first discussing with you all Arrhenius' theory of acid and base. So Arrhenius' theory of acid and base was the first theory given, and according to Arrhenius' theory, acid is any species which is capable of donating H positive ion in the aqueous solution. I will repeat it. According to Arrhenius' theory, an acid is a species which is capable of donating H positive, that is proton ions, in the aqueous solutions. We all know that HCl is a wonderful acid. When we dissolve it in water, it releases H positive and Cl negative ions. So hence it acts as acid according to Arrhenius' theory. Similarly, sulfuric acid, which is known as king of acids, is capable of donating two proton ions when dissolved in aqueous medium. So whenever we dissolve sulfuric acid in water, it will release two H positive ions in the aqueous solution. Nitric acid, again, it is also an acid according to Arrhenius' theory because it is capable of donating H positive ions when dissolved in the aqueous medium. Now this was all about Arrhenius' theory. What is an acid according to Arrhenius' theory? Secondly, what is a base according to Arrhenius' theory? Base is any substance which is capable of producing hydroxyl ions, that is OH negative ions, in the aqueous solutions. So what is Arrhenius' base? It is a species which will release OH negative ions when dissolved in aqueous medium. So examples of Arrhenius' bases are sodium hydroxide, potassium hydroxide. All of them are capable of donating OH negative ions when dissolved in aqueous medium. And the next topic is, what is the strength of acid and base? So acid is something which releases H positive according to Arrhenius' theory. Base is a species which releases OH negative ions. But there are certain acids, there are certain species which are capable of dissociating or giving proton ions very fastly, whereas there are some acids which do not dissociate completely into H positive ions. So on the basis of that, we divide acids into strong acid and a weak acid. Strong acid is a substance which dissociates itself completely into H positive ions. For example, if we have 5 molar HCl solution, it will give you 5 molar H positive ions. Okay, and hence it is known as strong acid. Whereas if we consider acetic acid, it is weak acid. When we dissolve it in water, when we dissolve 5 molar acetic acid in water, it will not give us 5 molar H positive ions into the solution. Only only partial dissociation of acid will take place. Hence, acetic acid is known as a weak acid. So this is about strength of an acid and strength of acids. There are certain acids which will release H positive ions very fastly. They will release H positive ions completely. They are known as strong acid. Under this category, we have HCl, we have sulfuric acid, nitric acid. Whereas a weak acid is a substance which dissociates only partially, or we can say that it poorly dissociates into ions in the aqueous solutions. So here we have given examples. HCl will give us H positive ion and Cl negative ions completely and emissions. So here we have given examples. HCl will give us H positive ion and Cl negative ions completely, and hence it is known as a strong acid. Similarly, when we consider acetic acid will release H positive ions only partially, and hence it is known as a weak acid. Now similarly, what is a strong base and a weak base? A strong base is a substance which completely dissociates into OH negative ions. here example of strong bases, sodium hydroxide. When we dissolve sodium hydroxide in water, for example, we have 5 molar sodium hydroxide, it will definitely give us 5 molar hydroxyl group in the aqueous solution. Whereas we consider ammonium hydroxide. Ammonium hydroxide is a weak base. It will not give us, it will not completely dissociate itself into ions. When we dissolve ammonium hydroxide in water, it will only partially or poorly dissociate into ions in the aqueous solutions. Okay, so next is a dissociation constant of acid or base. So how we will come to know which parameters are used to tell whether an acid is a strong acid or a weak acid. For this, we study dissociation constant of acid or a base. What is dissociation constant? Dissociation constant is basically the quantitative measure of the strength of an acid. Dissociation constant is the quantitative measure of the strength of acid in a solution. So what happens in this dissociation constant? We consider any reaction. For example, we consider HA acid, which gives us H positive ions and A negative ions in the aqueous medium. For in this equation, we are going to apply equilibrium. Equilibrium, and according to equilibrium, the dissociation constant is always given by concentration of products divided by concentration of reactant. So when HA dissociates into H positive ions and A negative ions, so what do you get? The dissociation constant will be given by KA is equal to concentration of products divided by concentration of the reactant, that is acid. Now any species which is having very high value of KA means it has definitely the numerator in the equation is more. If the value of Ka is more, that is the concentration of A negative and H positive proton ions is more, then it means that the acid has completely dissociated itself in the medium. I will repeat it again. From the dissociation constant, it is clear that if the value of dissociation constant is more, it means the value of the numerator in the equation is more. It means the acid has given more and more ions. It has dissociated itself into more and more ions. It means that our acid is strong. Whereas all those acids which are weak acids will have lower value of Ka. Lower value of Ka means in the equation, the denominator will be more as compared to the numerator. More value of denominator means the concentration of acid is more than the concentration of ions in the solution. So it implies that in the case of weak acid, value of Ka is less. It means the concentration of undissociated acid is more. It means that the acid has not dissociated. In the aqueous medium, we have more undissociated acid as compared to dissociated acid. So Ka is a parameter which is known as dissociation constant. This parameter is used to find out the strength of acid or a base. So any acid which have more value of Ka means it is a strong acid, whereas any acid which has lesser value of Ka means it is a weak acid. So all the acids such as HCl, nitric acid, sulfuric acid, which are very, very strong acids, which release H positive ions very rapidly, they all have more value of Ka. They have big values of Ka, whereas acetic acid, which is a weak acid, has lesser value of Ka. Lesser value of Ka means the acid has not dissociated into ions. We have undissociated dissociated acid present. So hence acetic acid being a weak acid has lower value of dissociation constant, whereas the strong acids will have higher value of dissociation constants. Now this dissociation constant is used to study the strength of acid or base. In case of acids, it is known as acid dissociation constant. And in the case of base, it is known as base dissociation constant. And what is this what is the numerical value of this acid dissociation constant? It is the same as that of dissociation constant. It is the concentration of the reactant. It is the concentration of products divided by the concentration of reactants. Okay. And from the dissociation constant, we come to know that what is the concentration of the ions or acid present at equilibrium. Next important term which we study while discussing the strength of acid or a base is pKa value. pKa value is nothing but minus log of Ka. pKa value is minus log of Ka. So all those species which have more value of Ka will definitely have less value of pKa, because pKa is negative log of Ka. So all those species like sulfuric acid, HCl, nitric acid, they have huge value of Ka because the concentration, they release H positive ions very quickly. But pKa value is going to be less, because pKa value is negative log of Ka. So this is also important parameter which we normally read while comparing the acidic value of acids. So here we have just substituted the value in the equation of pKa. We have substituted the value of Ka. pKa is equal to minus log Ka, so the value of Ka we have put it from the above equation. So the final result is pKa is equal to log concentration of ions divided by the concentration of undissociated acid. When we take the negative sign inside, the equation gets reversed and the concentration of acid goes up and the concentration of ions come down in the equation. Okay, so Ka, that is basically dissociation constant for an acid, is used to measure the position of equilibrium. We come by Ka value, we come to know about the position of equilibrium. Position of equilibrium means that if the value of Ka is going to be large, it means that the concentration of ions is much more. Concentration of ions is much more means that our reaction has moved in the forward direction and we are getting products. Whereas if the value of Ka is small, it means that our acid is present in undissociated form and the reaction has not gone in the forward direction, but the reaction is going in the backward direction and we are getting only acid in our equilibrium stage. So this was the main use of studying Ka, that is dissociation constant for acid. The dissociation constant tells us basically what are the products we are getting at equilibrium. If the Ka value is more, it means that we have got products, we have achieved our final product. Whereas if the Ka value is small, it means that our reaction has not gone in the forward direction and we have only undissociated acid present with us. Okay, so this is some data which is based upon the dissociation constant. If the value of Ka is large, it means that the value of pKa is going to be small, because we know that pKa is equal to minus log of Ka. If we have more value of Ka, that means more value of dissociation constant. It implies that our acid has dissociated into ions. It has dissociated into H positive ions. If we have more value of Ka, it means our acid is also strong. Our acid has dissociated into H positive ions, but the value of pKa is going to be small. So whenever we see strong acids, they all will be having pKa value less than minus 2. Okay, the value of Ka for strong acids is going to be large, but when we will see, when we will compare the pKa value, the pKa value is going to be very less, that is around minus 2 for strong acids. The exactly opposite happens for a weak acid. When we have a weak acid, the value of Ka is going to be small. It means our acid has not shown any dissociation and hence it is weak. But if the value of Ka is small, pKa is going to be large because pKa is minus log of Ka. Now in case of weak acids, the pKa value is going to be very large. That is, it is going to range from minus 2 to 12 in water. So this is the main result of this pKa values. For a strong acid, we will be having the value of pKa approximately less than minus 2. Whereas if our acid is weak, in case of weak acid, the value of pKa value is going to be from range minus 2 to 12. Never be confused between Ka and pKa. Always remember that in case of pKa, we are going in reverse direction. Ka simply tells us about the acidic strength, but pKa is the negative of minus negative log of Ka. So negative means more the stronger acid, lesser will be the value of pKa. Okay, so this was all about acid-base strength. Now we will be back to our topic, that is acid-base titrations. So what happens in acid-base titrations? Acid-base titrations are also known as neutralization reactions. In these reactions, acid neutralizes base, or we can say that base neutralizes acid to give salt and water. So we will be seeing in all the acid-base reactions, neutralization is going to take place between an acid and a base to give salt and water. Now, the standard solution of acid is used for the quantitative determination of alkalis. And the standard solution of base is used for the quantitative determination of acid. So why we study acid-base titrations? We study acid-base titrations to find out the concentration, to find out what is the molarity, what is the normality of the given sample of acid or base. For determining the strength of, for determining the concentration of an acid, we should have a standard solution of base. And for determining the concentration of unknown sample of a base, we should also have a standard solution of acid. So always remember in mind, if we want to determine the strength, we want to determine the concentration of an acid of any unknown sample, we should first prepare the standard solution of base whose concentration is known to us. Whereas if we want to find out the concentration of a base, we have to prepare a solution, standard solution of acid whose concentration is already known to us. Okay, so this is all we are going to do in acid-base titrations. For determining the strength of any unknown sample, we are going to keep the we are going to prepare another solution whose concentration is known to us, the solution which is going to behave as a standard solution for the determination of any unknown sample. Okay, all these reactions are carried out under standard volumetric titrations. In all these titrations, it is very important to, it is quantitative analysis. Even single drop of acid matters here. Okay, it is a quantitative analysis. And in these titrations, we determine the strength of the acid or a base very, very accurately. In all these titrations, we will study that we will be using indicators to find out the end point of the titrations. So firstly, we will be studying acidimetry titrations. In acidimetry titrations, we are going to find out the concentration of a base, unknown base, by using a strong acid. So what is acidimetry titration? In acidimetry titration, we are going to find out the concentration of the unknown base by using a standard solution of acid. Standard solution of acid can be like HCl sulfuric acid. Whereas alkalimetry titrations are those in which we will find out the concentration of a acid by using a standard solution of a base. Standard solution of base can be of that of sodium hydroxide or potassium hydroxide. Now we will discuss the different characteristics of acid-base titrations. We perform acid-base titrations, and in acid-base titrations, we observe the equivalence point. where equivalence point is obtained. All these parameters we will discuss step by step, and it will be more clear to everyone. These titrations are free from any side reactions. In acid-based titrations, we are basically dealing with ions. The reactions of ions are very, very fast, so no other interactions will play any role here. So being ionic reactions, these reactions are very, very fast, and hence they will be free from any side reactions, because we all know that ionic reactions are very, very fast as compared to other covalent reactions and all other interactions. So since these reactions are very fast, so they are completely free from any side reactions. And acid-based reactions are very fast. Once they once we mix the solutions, they will be going on very fast, and they will be always completed. Another important characteristic of acid-based titration is that the reactants always react with each other in stoichiometric proportions. For example, we consider a reaction where HCl is reacting with sodium hydroxide to give salt and water. In this reaction, we see that one mole of HCl reacts with one mole of sodium hydroxide to give one mole of salt. So this reaction, all these reactions, acid-based titrations, in acid-based titrations, all the reactions react with each other in a stoichiometric proportion. So we will just once again go through the characteristics of acid-based titrations. In acid-based titrations, equivalence point is achieved. Equivalence point is a point at which acid, for example, we want to determine the strength of an unknown acid. So equivalence point is a point at which all the acid, all the proton ions present in our unknown sample have completely reacted with the base ions, with the hydroxyl ions which we are adding on. I will repeat it. In acid-based titrations, we observe the equivalence point. Equivalence point is a point at which all the proton ions have reacted with, or we can say that all the proton ions have been neutralized by the hydroxyl ions which we have added from outside. So that point is known as equivalence point. Equivalence point is a point, a stage at which all the proton ions which we have in the aqueous medium have reacted with the OH negative ions to form salt and water. So in these reactions, we have to find out what is the equivalence point. What is the benefit of studying equivalence point? For example, if we have a solution, unknown sample, and we want to find out its acidic strength. We want to find out its acidic strength. We don't know the concentration of that particular solution to us. We will be adding base of the known concentration. We will be adding base of known concentration to that unknown sample of acid. We will be adding the base to the acid till the point of equivalence is obtained. The point of equivalence is the specific point in which all the acid, all the proton ions have been neutralized with the OH negative ions, which we are adding from the base. So by this theory, we will come to know the amount of hydroxyl ions which we have added from outside. The amount of hydroxyl ions which we have added from outside means that is the particular amount of the acid which is present in our unknown sample. I will repeat it. By coming to know the amount of base we are adding from outside, we will come to know about the protons which are present in the solution, because we know from our chemical equation that one mole of HCl is going to react with one mole of sodium hydroxide. So for example, if we are adding 20 ml of sodium hydroxide from outside to neutralize unknown sample of HCl, it means our HCl also contains 20 ml. We have that particular acid present in that also. So by relating this, we will come to know the HCl present in our solution. So this is the use of studying acid-based titrations. Because we know the concentration, the sodium hydroxide concentration, we know how much sodium hydroxide we have added. From that, we will come to know how much HCl or how much acid content is present in our reaction mixture. So this was the point of equivalence. We will discuss this more and with the help of indicators. Indicator is a chemical species. It is basically a weak acid or a base, which helps us to find out the point of equivalence. We know that most of the acids are colorless, bases are also colorless. So by normal mixing, we will not come to know when the point of equivalence is obtained. So the point of equivalence can be directly obtained from, we can know about the point of equivalence by indicator. Indicator gives us a very sharp point, a very sharp color change at the point of equivalence. So this is the use of indicator. In acid-based titrations, we will study equivalence point, a particular point at which all the acid content has been neutralized by the base content, and this point will be indicated to us by indicator. Second characteristic was these reactions, because they are ionic, are very, very fast, and hence they are free from any side reactions. Ionic reactions, being very, very fast, are very, very fast, and hence they are free from any side reactions. Third characteristic of acid-based titration is that they always complete because, being very fast, they take few seconds for the completion, and hence they complete very fast. And the last point was the reactants always react with each other in stoichiometric proportions. Next are the different theories of acid-based titrations. Different theories were given to explain these acid-based titrations, why are they studied, and we will study all these theories one by one. The aim of every titration, what is the aim of titration, why we are mixing solutions, what is the purpose of carrying out this titration? The aim of every titration is to get exact volume, which is directly proportional to the amount of substance under investigation. This is what I was explaining earlier. The aim of this acid-based titration is to find the exact volume of the solution which we are dissolving to react with the substance which is under investigation. Okay, for example, we will clear this with more and more examples. It will be more clear. For example, when we are carrying out acid-based titrations, we calculate the exact amount of base which is required to neutralize the acid. For example, we have unknown sample of acid. What our main purpose is? Our main purpose is to find out the exact amount of base which is required to neutralize the acid. The specific point at which neutralization of complete acid with the base takes place is known as equivalence point. So what is equivalence point? It is a specific point at which all the acid content in our unknown sample has reacted with the base. In all the acid-based titrations, we add indicator. Most of you might have studied acid-based titrations in organic chemistry in plus two. All might have performed the reaction of oxalic acid with sodium hydroxide. Always the solution of oxalic acid was taken as a standard solution. Standard solution means whose concentration is fixed. We know the concentration of oxalic acid and we find out the concentration of sodium hydroxide. So in that reactions, if you remember, we always used to add some indicator. For example, phenolphthalein. By phenolphthalein, when we use phenolphthalein as indicator, it changes its color from colorless to pink. The observance of pink color always tells us that the end point of the reaction is obtained, and we have to measure which amount of base which amount of acid we have used. So we will discuss that further in more detail. And for in acid-based titrations, our main purpose is to find out the end point of the reaction. End point of the reaction is nothing but the equivalence point. Equivalence point is the point at which acid completely neutralizes base. So what is indicator? Indicators are the substances or solutions which show color changes when equivalence point is obtained. For example, when we perform the titration of acid and a base, acid and base, as I told you, they are colorless. Okay, when equivalence point will be obtained, we will not come to know that equivalence point has been observed. So how you will come to know that equivalence point has been obtained? Because both the solutions are colorless. The endpoint is obtained by use of indicator. The purpose of using indicator is to find out that the endpoint or the equivalence point of the reaction has been obtained. So indicators are the substances or they are the solutions. Indicators are the substances or solutions which show color changes in accordance with the titrations. So normally we do not come to know about the equivalence point, but indicators, they show us by the color change that the endpoint has been observed. For example, phenolphthalein. The reaction, when we use phenolphthalein as indicator, it is a very common indicator. I think most of you might have been dealing with phenolphthalein, and many of the reactions have already been studied in plus two. Indicators such as phenolphthalein changes its color on different pH. Phenolphthalein is colorless in the acidic medium, whereas it is pink in the basic medium. So when the pH of the solution changes, indicator is going to change its color, and hence we will come to know that endpoint has been obtained. Because for example, we are dealing with acid and base. Let us consider that we have acid in our titration flask. We have to find the concentration of acid. So we have taken that in titration flask. We are adding sodium hydroxide into it. So what is going to happen when, first of all, before starting the reaction, in the solution of oxalic acid, any acid, we will be adding phenolphthalein. When we will add phenolphthalein into acid, its color will remain colorless. But on the addition of base, when we will be adding base drop by drop, we will see that acid will be neutralizing base and no change in color will be observed. Although we are adding base, but still no change in the color will be observed. We normally expect that indicator should change its color because we have indicator in our flask. So if we are adding base from outside, the color of the solution should change, but the color is not changed because all the base which we are adding in the solution is neutralizing the acid. It is not changing the pH. It is not going to change the pH to the basic side, but it is just going to neutralize the acid. So drop by drop, when we will be adding base, all the base will be used up in neutralizing the acid. A specific point in the reaction will be obtained when all the acid content will be neutralized by the base which we are adding from outside. A specific point which is known as equivalence point will be obtained, at which all the acid, all the proton ions have been neutralized by the base ions, that is hydroxyl ions, which we are adding from outside. That particular point is known as equivalence point. Now, after the equivalence point, it means all the acid and all the base have been converted into salt and water. After the next drop of base, which we are going to add from outside, our solution will become basic because there is no more acid which has to be neutralized. Now the base is free to give OH negative ions into the medium. Now the base is going to increase the pH of the solution, and we know that phenolphthalein in the basic medium is going to also change its color from colorless to pink. So this is the main things which are happening in the acid base titrations. At the lower pH, since the phenolphthalein is colorless, there will be no color shown to us, but as the pH is going to increase, as we are going to increase the pH, as the solution's pH will increase, the color of indicator is going to change. So this is the purpose of using indicator. Indicators are the substances or they are the solutions which show various color changes in accordance with titrations. Indicators are the substances, they will change the color. In different pH, they will have different color, and on different pH, they will be having different color. So hence, indicators are very, very useful to determine the endpoint of the reaction. We will come to know at where we have to stop the addition of base into our mixture. okay. In this process of acid-base titrations, the pH of the titrant is altered. As we have seen that the pH is going to change because earlier we have taken unknown sample of acid. Unknown sample of acid, acid means its pH is going to be, low. But when we will be adding sodium hydroxide into it, the pH is going to be increasing and hence the pH is going to change. So always in all the acid-base titrations, the pH is going to change. This was the case when we have taken acid in a titration flask. We were to find out the concentration of acid. But if we take, if we want to determine the concentration of the base, we want to find out what is the molarity, what is the concentration of the base, then we have to take base in the titration flask and we have to do the addition of acid, standard acid solution into it. Here now the color will be different. Now since in the beaker in our titration flask we have a basic medium, we have a basic solution, so the pH will be pink. On the addition of acid from outside, our base will be neutralized with acid. Again, a point, a specific point which is known as equivalence point will be obtained, at which all the OH negative ions of the base will be neutralized with the H positive ions of the acid. That point is known as equivalence point. After that point, the single drop of acid which we will be adding will change the pH of the solution, and our solution is going to be now acidic. And in case of acidic medium, our phenolphthalein is also going to change its color. Now its color will be changed from pink to colorless. So this is going to be reverse. So in this process of acid-base titrations, the pH of the titrant is altered. We are going to, the pH is, as we have seen, we are adding base or we are adding acid. So the definitely the pH is going to be changed. Therefore, the substance which changes the color of the solvent is accordance with the pH. What indicators do? They change the color of the solvent in accordance with the pH. At different pH, they are going to be having different colors. All those indicators which we are using for acid-base titrations are known as neutralization indicators. Neutralization term is basically the term because acid neutralizes a base. We are studying acid-base titrations. We are studying neutralization reactions. And hence, the indicator which are used in these titrations will be neutralization indicators. All those indicators which we are using in acid-base titrations, that is neutralization reactions, are known as neutralization indicators. There are certain rules used for selection of indicators. The rules for the selection of indicators are: always you should take care in choosing the indicator, otherwise they will cause error. Okay, the errors will be observed in the titration. For example, we want to study a reaction at a pH, for example, 2 to 3. If we are taking an indicator which changes the color at 7 or 8, then that indicator is not going to work out for that reaction. It means that we have to very smartly select which indicator has to be used in which reaction. For example, our equivalence point is observed at pH 7, then we have to use indicator which is effective, which works at that particular pH range. If we are using another, we are using an indicator which works at different range, different pH range, and our equivalence point is observed at different point, then that indicator is of no use. Okay, and the second selection, second point which we have to take care while the selection of indicators is neutralization reactions change color on introduction to H positive or OH negative ions. As we have seen that indicators, the neutralization indicators, they change their color. They are very sensitive to pH. So on the introduction of proton or hydroxyl groups, they are going to change their colors. Okay. Introduction of these ions obviously alter the solution. Whenever we are adding H positive ions or hydroxyl ions, definitely the pH of the solution is going to change, and the color change of the indicator in the selection of indicators depend upon the pH only. The color change is very, very specific to the pH range. So this is all we have to keep in mind, that what the equivalence point is and at which range our indicator works. If they coincide, only then your indicator will work. Otherwise, the indicator is not going to work. For example, in acid-base titrations, we know that the equivalence point of acid neutralizing a base and base neutralizing an acid is obtained as pH 7. At pH 7, we have neither acid ions or we don't have base ions, or we can say that the number of acid ions, that is protons, and the base ions, that is hydroxyl ions, are exactly the same. There is no one to dominate. So the equivalence point in acid-base titrations normally is at pH 7. Now, phenolphthalein is capable of giving color change at that pH. So hence, in acid-base titrations, we can use phenolphthalein. Okay. So there, these are some more indicators besides phenolphthalein. Now, bromophenol blue, that is basically effective, that works at pH range 3 to 4.6. And it changes its color from yellow to blue. In acidic conditions, its color is yellow, whereas in basic conditions, its color is blue. Next indicator is methyl orange. Methyl orange is effective at pH 3.1 to 4.4, and its color in acidic medium is red, whereas its color in basic medium will change into yellow. Next is methyl red. Methyl red works at, it is effective at pH 4.2 to 6.3. It shows color variation at this range. And what is the color change in this? In acidic medium, its color is red, whereas in basic medium, its color is low. Phenol red, it shows a pH range at 6.8 to 8.4. And again, it changes its color from red to orange. It is red in acidic medium, whereas it is orange in basic medium. Next is crisol red. It shows color variation from 7.2 to 8.8. Its color is yellow in acidic medium, whereas its color is red in basic medium. Phenolphthalein, it's colorless in acidic medium, and it is basic in basic medium. It changes its color from pink, slight pink, or you can say reddish color. Next is thiamol blue. Its pH ranges from 1.2 to 2.8. It changes its color from red to yellow as the concentration, as the pH goes from acidic pH to basic pH. Then we have metacrisol purple. It changes its color from yellow to violet, and its pH ranges 7.4 to 9.0. Next is paranitrophenol. It is effective at 5.6 to 7.6 pH range. And its color is acidic. Its color is colorless in acidic medium, whereas its color is yellow in basic medium. 2,4-dinitrophenol. It is effective at 2.6 to 4 pH range, and its color is acidic in its color is colorless in acidic medium, whereas its color is yellow in basic medium. And the last one is 1-naphthol-phthalein. Its color is 7.3, its pH range is effective, it's effective in the pH range from 7.3 to 8.7, and its color changes from yellow to blue. As a pH changes from acidic to basic pH, the color is going to change from yellow to blue. So these were some more indicators. Okay, so we can see that acid-base titrations are incomplete. You cannot perform acid-base titrations without indicators. Indicators are very important for studying acid-base titrations. So basically, what are indicators? Now we will study what are indicators and what are the different theories related to these indicators. So what are acid-base indicators? Acid-base indicators are weak organic acids or bases. Indicators are nothing but they are weak organic acids or bases which produce color in acidic or basic medium. Okay, so what are acid-base indicators? So they are nothing, they are just weak acids or bases which show color variation either in acidic medium or in basic medium. Like we have seen phenolphthalein, it was colorless in the acidic medium, whereas its color was beautiful, you can say that pink or red color in the basic medium. Okay, similarly, methyl red, it is an organic compound, and it gives endpoint in the acidic medium. It changes, it have different color in acidic medium, different color in the basic medium. Methyl red has red color in the basic, in the acidic medium, whereas it has yellow color in the basic medium. Okay, so for the explanation of these indicators, how they work, it seems like a mystery how they work. How are indicators working? Why they change? Why they show color variation? So different theories were given for explaining the working of indicators. So we will discuss now the theories of acid-base indicators. So two theories which have been proposed to explain the color of acid-base indicators with the change in pH were, first one is Ostwald theory. It was given by scientist Ostwald, and according to him, that why the color variation is observed, why indicator changes its color in different medium was, according to him, the first point is, the color change is due to the ionization of acid-base indicator. So according to him, the color change was nothing, just because of ionization of acid-base indicator. When indicator ionizes, it gives different color, and the undissociated compound has different color according to him, and the dissociated, or you can say ionized, compound has different color. So according to Ostwald, why the indicators change color, according to him, whenever we are using indicators, when they are present in undissociated form, they have different color, and when they dissociate, when they ionize, they have different color. Okay, so this was the main mystery behind this, according to him, that the color changes is due to the ionization of acid-base indicator. The unionized form have different color, whereas the ionized form have different color. Second point, according to his theory was, the ionization of indicator is largely affected in acids and bases, as it is either a weak acid or a weak base. So we know that indicator is either a weak acid or weak base. Okay, so we know that it is a weak acid or a weak base. If you are having, for example, if your indicator is a weak acid, if you have a strong acid with it, you're using a strong acid with it, strong acid is going to affect the activity, it is going to affect the indicator, because it is itself a weak acid. Strong one is going to work more instead of weak acid. So you can say that the ionization of indicator is affected by acids and bases, because it is itself a very weak. Okay, it is not going to give, it is not going to dissociate till all the strong acids have dissociated. Or if you have an indicator which is a weak base, it is not going to dissociate into OH negative ions unless all the strong bases have given OH negative ions. So we can say that basically the ionization, or you can say the activity of indicator, is largely affected by the acids or bases which we are using. So in case the indicator is a weak acid, its ionization is very low in acids due to common H positive ion effects. This is known as common I effect, common ionic effect. In common ionic effect, a strong acid will not allow the indicator, because it is a weak acid, it is not going to allow the weak acid to give H positive ions very, very easily. It will not allow the weak acid to give H positive ions very, very fast because of the common ionic effect. Okay, while it is fairly ionized in alkalis. Now a weak acid will not ionize itself into a strong acid solution because of the ionic effect. Okay, because already strong acid has given lot of H positive ions. So because of common ionic effect, the strong acid will not allow the weak acid to release H positive ions rapidly. So because of the common ionic effect, weak acid's ionization is going to be very, very low. Whereas if you dissolve a weak acid in alkali medium, in the basic medium, it will definitely release H positive ions because there is no more competition going on. Whereas when you are using a weak acid in a strong acid, then its ionization will be low. Whereas the weak acid will ionize itself very easily, or you can say it will ionize itself rapidly in the alkali medium. Similarly, the same thing goes for base also. If your indicator is a weak base and you dissolve it in a strong base, it is not going to release, or it is not going to ionize itself into hydroxyl ions because of common ionic effect, Whereas whenever you dissolve weak base in a strong acid, then the ionization of the acid will be more. So this theory was given by Ostwald. The theory which we are going to study was given by Ostwald. Some derivations will be going on. We will be understanding this with the help of some equations. First of all, to understand this, let us consider an indicator which is a weak acid. So we have taken an indicator that is represented by HIN. Okay, it is a weak acid, and it is represented by HIN. HIN being a weak acid, it will dissociate itself into H positive ion and I negative ion. Since HIN is a weak acid, it will dissociate, it will give H positive ions, and it will give H positive ions and IN negative anions. Okay, now when we use this indicator, we place this indicator in an acid, in a strong acid, the following equilibrium will take place. For example, we have HIN, that is a weak acid, that is an indicator. It will give us H positive ions and IN negative ions. And also we have a strong acid with it. Now what we have done, we have put the acidic indicator in the strong acid. Now what is going to happen? Two reactions are going to take place simultaneously, because indicator is also weak acid, it is also going to release H positive ions. And we have put it in a strong acid, that is HA. For example, we have taken it as HA. HA being an acid, a strong acid, it is also going to release H positive ions and A negative ions. Now we can see both of these reactions. In case of indicator, it has also released H positive ions. The strong acid has also released H positive ions. So this ion is common in both the reactions. So this ion, that is H positive ion, is common in both the reactions. So common, this effect is known as common ionic effect. Because of this common ion effect, the indicator is not going to dissociate into H positive ions. The indicator is not going to dissociate into H positive ions because of the common ion effect. Here, common ion effect takes place, which suppresses the further dissociation of indicator. As the result, there is no change in color. Now, when we are using acidic indicator in a strong acid, what is going to happen? The H positive ions being a common ion in both the cases, is not going to show further dissociation. Indicator is not going to show further dissociation because of the ionic effect, common ion effect, it is not going to show any dissociation. If our indicator has not undergone dissociation, it is not going to show any color change, because we know that indicator shows color change only when it will undergo dissociation. Because of the common ion effect, we are not observing any dissociation of the acid, and hence the indicator is not going to show any dissociation, and hence there will be no color change. Now let us consider we have dissolved our acidic indicator in a base. Now we are going to dissolve our acidic indicator in a base. Now what an acidic indicator is going to do, same way it is represented by HIN, it is going to release H positive ions and IN negative ions. Now since we are having a base, now base means any species according to our Heinous concept, any species which is capable of donating hydroxyl ions in the aqueous medium. So we have dissolved it in a base. Now base is going to release OH negative ions, MOH is going to dissociate itself into M positive ions and OH negative ions. Now here there is no common ion effect, we cannot see any common ion effect, and hence there is no common ion effect taking place. Now this reaction is very very fast. Why is this reaction very fast? Because the H positive ions which indicator has given will be neutralized by the base ions which are present in our medium. I will repeat it, the H positive ions which our indicator has released have been neutralized by the OH negative ions which have been released by our base. So since the neutralization of H positive ions and OH negative ions have taken place, it means that the concentration of H positive has gone low because all the proton ions have neutralized it with the OH negative ions. Now since the concentration of H positive ions have fallen down, according to Lee-Chatelier principle, our indicator is going to now dissociate more into H positive ions and IN negative ions. I will repeat it. Since there is no ionic effect observed here, moreover, the H positive ions which the indicator has produced by ionization are neutralized by the base ions, OH negative ions, which are already present in the medium. Because of the neutralization of the H positive ions and OH negative ions, we can say that the H positive ions have been neutralized, have been finished up. Now, according to Lee-Chatelier principle, since the concentration of product has decreased, the reaction will move in the forward direction so that it can produce more product. So what is going to happen? The product here is nothing but proton ions. Now our indicator is going to release H positive ions and IN negative ions. So because of the neutralization, since the concentration of protons have gone down, according to Lee-Chatelier principle, our reaction will move forward in the forward direction. It will move in the forward direction. And when our reaction is going to move in the forward direction, our indicator is going to be dissociated. And when indicator will dissociate, definitely we will observe color change. So hence we can say that acidic indicator will not show any color change in the acidic medium, whereas our acidic indicator will show a color change in the basic medium. This is this we are going to apply on an example. Now phenolphthalein is a weak acidic indicator, and you might have observed the color of phenolphthalein is colorless in the acidic medium. It doesn't show any color because it has not dissociated itself. But in the basic medium, phenolphthalein is a weak acid. In the basic medium, it will undergo dissociation. When it will undergo dissociation, it will also show us color change. Hence, phenolphthalein is colorless in the acidic medium because it is a weak acid. It is not going to show any dissociation in the acidic medium. Okay. Whereas in the basic medium, it will undergo dissociation, and on dissociation, you will observe that the color will change. So this can be explained as, in the first reaction, we have an acid that is H positive. For example, we have taken any acid that is HA, it is going to dissociate into H positive ions and A negative ions. And we have a base, we can take any journal base that is MOH. MOH is going to dissociate into M positive and OH negative ions, okay? In acidic medium, its dissociation is going to decrease. It is not going to go, the indicator is not going to undergo any dissociation. Since it is not going to undergo any dissociation, hence its color will be, it will remain in the same color. Whereas in basic medium, it is going to undergo dissociation and hence its color will change. Now, phenolphthalein, since I told you that it is a weak acid means it will release H positive ions, not very fast, but it is going to release H positive ions partially. So I have represented phenolphthalein as HPH, and HPH is going to, that is phenolphthalein, since it is a weak acid, it is going to dissociate itself into H positive ions and pH negative ions. Now, when we put it into an acidic medium, HA, any acidic medium, that is, for example, we have taken it as HA, it is also going to release H positive ions and A negative ions. Now, since H positive ions are common, now H positive ions are common in both the equations, so common ion effect will be observed. Because of the common ion effect, direction of indicator will no more proceed in the forward direction. It will stop. It will not proceed in the forward direction, and we will not be getting any dissociated phenolphthalein. No dissociated phenolphthalein means no change in color. Now let us put our phenolphthalein into basic medium. In basic medium, no ion, common ion effect is observed, and hence the dissociation will take place. When dissociation will take place, phenolphthalein dissociation will take place, color change will be observed. Now let us consider an indicator which is a weak organic base. Now first of all, we have taken indicator which was a weak acid. Now we will take an indicator which is a weak organic base. Weak organic base, so we will be representing it by INOH. INOH means that it has tendency to release hydroxyl ions into the medium. Now we will observe different cases. We will dissolve it in acid now. First of all, we will dissolve it in acid. The weak organic base, that is INOH, will release IN positive ion and hydroxyl ions. Okay, so since our indicator now it is a weak organic base, it is going to dissociate into OH negative ions. And since we have put it in a acidic medium, our acid is going to release same H positive ions and A negative ions. Here, what is going to happen? First of all, we have no ionic effect, no common ion effect. The products are different, so no common ion effect will be observed. Whereas the OH negative ions, which have been produced by the indicator on dissociation, are neutralized by the H positive ions, which acid has released. So OH negative ions have been neutralized by the H positive ions. Now, since our product has been consumed, according to Lee-Chatelier principle, since the product, wherever the concentration is going to decrease, a reaction is going to take place in that direction, so that the same concentration on the side, each side can be met. So what is going to happen, since the OH negative ions have been finished up because of the neutralization of H positive ions, the indicator is going to dissociate. When the indicator is going to dissociate, it will release more and more OH negative ions. And when the dissociation of base is going to take place, the color of the indicator is going to change. The color, it will show dissociation, and hence the color will also change. Whereas when we place basic indicator in basic solution, what is going to happen? The weak base is going to release OH negative ions and form IN positive ion. Now, since we are using a basic solution, it will release M positive ions and OH negative ions. OH negative ions are common in both the reactions. OH negative ions being common in both the equations will show common ion effect. Because of common ion effect, your acid, your indicator is not going to dissociate more. It is not going to dissociate in, it is not going to move in the forward direction. If the indicator is not going to dissociate, and hence it is not going to show any change in color. So this was basically the theory given by Ostwald. According to Ostwald, the change in color is due to the ionization of acid base indicator. Okay, the change in the color of indicator is due to ionization of acid base. Unionized form have different color, ionized form have different color. Secondly, according to him, since an indicator is a weak acid or a weak base, its activity, its ionization is greatly affected by acids and bases present in the medium. Okay, so hence we have seen that, for example, if we take an indicator which is a weak acid, it will not show dissociation. Our indicator will not show dissociation in the acidic medium because of the common ionic effect, whereas our indicator, weak base indicator, is not going to show any dissociation in the basic medium. Weak acid indicator is going to show dissociation in the basic medium only, and the weak basic indicator is going to show the color variation in the acidic medium only. So this was all about the Ostwald theory. Ostwald theory was capable of explaining certain question queries in our mind, but it was not enough, all enough for explaining everything. For example, it just tells us that dissociated ions and undissociated ions have different color, but it does not relate it to the structure. It is not relating the change of the color to the structure of the molecule. It's just going on dissociation only. It is not telling us why different indicators show different color. It was not capable, it was not enough for explaining those theories also. It was just, according to his theory, the color variation was just because of the dissociation of indicator and nothing more. But there were some more theories, more questions in our mind also, why different indicators are showing different colors, and how the activity of indicator is related to its structures. First of all, before discussing the next theory, I will just show you the color variation of phenolphthalein and methyl orange. Phenolphthalein, the structure of phenolphthalein is represented here. Okay, so here we can see that there are three benzene rings, and these three benzene rings are fused to each other. They are connected to each other, and we have OH ions. We have OH, that is hydroxyl ions, attached to the benzene ring. Since the hydroxyl ions are attached to the benzene ring, it shows properties that of phenol, and we know that phenols are weak acids. They have capability of dissociating themselves into H positive ions, and hence phenolphthalein also behaves as a weak acid because of the presence of these OH groups. It is not a very strong acid because it is organic molecule. It is not very strong acid. Okay, so phenolphthalein is represented here, and we can see that the color of phenolphthalein is colorless in the acidic medium, whereas it is pink, light pink in the alkali basic medium. Okay, and what does phenolphthalein do? Since it is a weak acid, it is going to release H positive ions, HIN. It is going to release H positive ions and IN negative ions. The undissociated molecules of phenolphthalein, they are colorless. The undissociated molecules of phenolphthalein are colorless, as we can see in acidic medium. Since it is an acid, it is a weak acid, it is in the undissociated form in the acidic medium, and hence we can see it is colorless. Whereas the dissociated form of phenolphthalein, it is pink in color, which is observed in basic medium. In the presence of an acid, the ionization of phenolphthalein is going to be negligible because of the common ionic effect. Phenolphthalein is not going to release H positive ions because of the common ionic effect, and hence it is not going to show any dissociation, and hence its color remains colorless. Whereas on the addition of alkali, when we will be adding alkali solution into it, what is going to happen? The alkali medium is going to accept the H positive ions, which will be released by the phenolphthalein. So the H positive ions, which will be released by the phenolphthalein, will be taken up by the alkali medium. And on the loss of H positive ions, you will see that the phenolphthalein has undergone dissociation, and the dissociated form has different color, that is, it has pink color. So on addition of alkali, hydrogen ions are removed by OH negative ions and since the H positive ions have been used by the alkali medium. Okay, that's positive ions which we have, that's positive ions which have been given up by phenolphthalein. They have been used by the alkali medium, and you can say that all the H positive ions have been consumed up. Now more phenolphthalein molecule is going to release H positive ions, or we can say that phenolphthalein will undergo dissociation on the addition of alkali hydrogen ions, which have been released by the phenolphthalein indicator, will be consumed by the OH negative ions. Since the H positive ions have been consumed up by the OH negative ions, the reaction will proceed in the forward direction, because since the concentration of the products have gone down, now the position of the equilibrium will be in the forward direction. The reaction is going to proceed in the forward direction. Since when the reaction is going to proceed in the forward direction, the more and more phenolphthalein molecules will undergo dissociation. So, and when more and more phenolphthalein molecules are going to undergo dissociation, its color will change. Next example is methyl orange. In methyl orange, we can see this is the structure of methyl orange. Okay, and in the basic medium, this ring is going to dissociate. The ring is going to dissociate, and many other changes have taken place. Here, the benzene ring. From the benzene form, it has changed itself into another form, quinone form. Okay, now methyl orange, it is an intensively colored compound. This is the color of methyl orange. It is also used in dyeing and printing textiles. And methyl orange is used as an indicator in acid-base titrations also. The color of methyl orange is red orange at lower pH, that is at approximately 3.1 pH, that is on the acidic side, lower pH, its color is orange, its color is red, whereas as the pH goes to 4.4, that is as we go to the higher pH, to the basic side, the color of the indicator changes to orange yellow. This pH related or color changes, they help us in finding out the endpoint of the indicator. Okay, from this all these pH changes, color changes which are related to pH, are very beneficial for us in finding out the endpoint of the reaction. Now, what are the disadvantages of Ostwald theory? First of all, what are the advantages of Ostwald theory? Advantages of using Ostwald theory is that there is a possibility of quantitative interpretation of the results of the change of color. So there is a quantitative interpretation. We can see that on the lower pH, why the color is different. It is basically telling us everything in a quantitative manner. With the single pH range, why the color changes. It's enough to explain the color changes on the basis of the pH. Okay, but there are certain other drawbacks of Ostwald theory. The drawbacks of Ostwald theory are that it is not able to explain the color variation on the basis of its structure. So let's read out the disadvantages of Ostwald theory. Different color of acid and basic forms. There are different colors of acid and basic forms. It was not able to explain why different indicators give different colors. Okay, it was not able to explain that. Second disadvantage of Ostwald theory was that it was not able to correlate structure and coloring. Okay, it was not able to explain why different structures give different colors. It was not able to explain that. Now, third disadvantage of Ostwald theory was that since acid-base reaction is an ionic reaction, so it should undergo very, very fast. But why it takes time for the color change to take place? Okay, there was no answer of all these questions by Ostwald. So these all are disadvantages. First of all, he was not able to correlate the structure and the color. He was not able to tell why different structures give different colors. He was not able to explain that. The second problem in his theory was that he was not able to explain that although acid-base titrations, since they are ionic titrations, they are very, very fast, why since the reactions are very fast still, why they take time for the color change to take place, why the time has been taken for the color change. Okay, so all these were the disadvantages. So next theory of indicator was given to overcome the drawbacks of Ostwald theory, that is Cunonoid theory. Now, according to, there are certain rules, there are certain postulates of this theory. According to Cunonoid theory, acid-base indicators, they exist in tautomeric forms. They exist in equilibrium with each other. They exist in two tautomeric forms, which are having different structures. And these two tautomeric forms are in equilibrium with one another. Okay, so let us consider these two forms. This form is known as benzoid form because the structure of this form is related to benzene. There are alternative, double and single bonds here. So the structure of this form is related to benzene. So this form is known as benzoid form. The another form is known as cunonoid form. In the cunonoid form, why is this known as cunonoid form? Because its structure is related to cunonone. In cunonone, we have the structure is similar to this tautomer, and we have an carbonyl group on both the sides. Okay, so according to this theory, the acid and all the acid base indicators, they exist in two forms. That is cunonoid form and benzoid form. Benzoid form has structure similar to that of benzene. Cunonoid has structure similar to that of cunone. And these two forms are in equilibrium with one another. We can say that acid base indicators, they exist, they show tautomeric isomerism. They exist in two tautomeric forms. Okay, both these forms are in equilibrium with one another. Okay. Now the two forms here, they have different colors. Okay, the two forms, that is the benzoid form or cunonoid form, they have different colors. The color change is because of the interconversion of one tautomeric form into another. So why the color variation has been observed? Because different tautomers have different colors. Like benzoid might be having different color and cunonoid might be having different color. So when cunonoid form changes into benzoid form, the color variation is going to be observed because the two tautomers, they have different colors. Okay, now next postulate of this theory was one form mainly exists in acidic medium and another form exists in alkaline medium. So according to this theory, one form will predominantly exist in acidic medium and another form is going to exist in basic medium. Okay. Thus, during the titration, when we are performing the titration, when we are performing acid-base titrations, the pH is going to change. Our solution is either going to change from acidic to alkaline or it is going to change from alkaline to acidic. Okay, so what is going to happen? For example, if we have a benzoid form in acidic medium, then it is going to change into cunonone form in the alkaline medium. And when the pH of the medium is going to change, or when you can say acidic medium is going to change into alkaline medium, your different tautomer, the tautomer is going to change. If it was in benzoid form, it is going to go into the another form, and hence the color variation is going to be observed. The change in the pH converts, whenever there is a change in the pH, it converts one tautomeric form into another, and because of this, the color is going to change. So these were the main points of cunonoid theory. In cunonoid theory, according to this theory, all the acid base indicators, they exist in two tautomeric forms and they have different structures. Okay, the two forms here have been represented here. The first form is benzoid form because the structure of this form, tautomeric form, is similar to that of benzene, and another one is known as cunonoid form because the structure is related to cunonone. Okay, these two forms are in equilibrium with one another. Whenever both these forms have different colors in the different pH range.
Okay, so whenever in acid base titrations, since we know that the pH variation is going to take place, and hence different form is going to exist at different pH, and different another form is going to exist at different pH. On the basis of the tautomeric form which we have at that particular pH, the color of indicator is going to change. Thus, during the titration, the medium changes its color, and hence the indicator is going to change its color on the change in the pH. The color change shown by the compound, the drawback of Ostwald theory was that it was not able to relate the color change by its structure. But that drawback has been overcome by this theory. Now, the color change which is shown by the compound is associated with its capability of the compound to absorb visible light. So there are different compounds, they absorb different lights. It all depends upon its electronic structure. Different compounds have different electronic structures, they have different sigma bonds, they have different pi bonds, and hence on the basis of that they can absorb different light. Okay, they can absorb different light, and the light which they will absorb, the complementary color of the light will be seen. For example, if we have any compound, it absorbs the red portion of the light. Our light consists of seven colors, that is in the seven colors in the vibrio. If the compound absorbs the red portion of the light, then the compound is going to show which color? It is going to show the complementary color, that is it is going to show blue purple color. Whereas if your compound has a capability to absorb which portion of the light, if it has the capability to absorb the blue portion of the light, then it is going to show complementary color, which will be reddish orange color. Okay, so this theory was able to correlate that the color shown by the compound is associated with the capability of the compound to absorb visible light. It is related to the capability of the compound that it absorbs which particular part of the visible light, and this is completely related to its electronic structure. On the basis of its electronic structure, it is going to absorb light, and the complementary color is going to be visible to us. If we change the electronic feature, for example, when we change the electronic feature, if we change the electronic configuration of the compound, the compound will absorb different color, and hence it will be visible to us in different color. For example, benzoid. Another form of benzoid is quinonoid. Okay, the benzene has capability of absorbing different color because its electronic configuration, its electronic structure is different as compared to its another tautomeric form. So benzene will absorb different color, and its complementary color will be shown to us. Whereas the another tautomeric form, that is quinonoid, it has capability of absorbing different color, and hence the different color and the supplementary different color will be visible to us. So on the change in the electronic feature, as the electronic environment of the compound is going to change, as it is moving from benzene form to quinonoid form, its electronic structure is changing. On the change in the electronic structure, it is going to absorb different light, and hence different supplementary color is going to be shown to us. For example, we will understand this theory more by considering an example, that is para-nitrophenol. In para-nitrophenol, we have a phenol, that is a hydroxyl group, and nitro group is present at the para position. Now, this para-nitrophenol, it is colorless when we have it in the benzoid form. It is colorless, but as the pH changes, it is going to change from benzoid form to quinonoid form. When it is going to change from benzoid form to quinonoid form, its electronic structure has changed. Because of the change in the electronic structure, the color will also change, because we know that on the change, with the change in the electronic structure, it is going to absorb different portion of light. If it is going to absorb different portion of light, it is going to show different color. Okay, so we will understand this example more. Paranitrophenol, it can exist in two forms, benzoid form and quinonoid form. Okay, and it is going to change its color in the different pH. For example, consider this indicator, paranitrophenol. In the benzoid form, its color is colorless, whereas in the quinonoid form, its color is yellow. So as the pH is going to change, the benzoid form is going to be converted into quinonoid form, or you can say that quinonoid form will be changed into benzoid form, and hence the color change will be observed from colorless to yellow. Okay, and I just want to explain a little more about this color. The color change, it depends upon the presence of unsaturated chromophoric group. Chromophoric group means, this chromophoric word is derived from word chromo. Chromo means color. Chromophoric group is responsible for providing color to the indicator molecule. For example, the different examples of chromophoric groups have been discussed here below are nitro group. Nitro group has different color in its one tautomeric form, whereas it has different color in its another tautomeric form, because of the presence of all these chromophoric group, which is nitro group or azo group or quinone group. What is going to happen? The color of the molecule is going to change. These chromophoric groups are responsible for the color variation of the solution. Okay, chromophoric groups, they might be having lone pair of electrons, or they might be having a double bond unsaturation in them. Okay, so what are chromophoric groups? Chromophoric groups are the compounds having unsaturation, or they might be having double bonds in conjugation with one another. They are capable of giving the color. They provide color to the medium. Oxochromes are oxochrome is another class which contains lone pair of electrons. Oxochromes, they do not have any colors. They do not have any color of its own. But when it gets attached to chromophore, it increases its color intensity. So what are chromophoric groups? Chromophoric groups are responsible for the change of the color of indicators. And oxochromes are itself colorless. They have lone pair of electrons. For example, hydroxyl group, it has two lone pair of electrons. Amine group, it has lone pair of electrons. Although it does not have any color, but when it is attached with chromophore, it is attached with chromophoric group, it increases the color intensity of the sample. Now, three chromophoric groups have been listed here. Now, nitro group exists in two equilibrium forms. It exists in two equilibrium forms. In the one tautomeric form, it has different color, and in the another tautomeric form, it has different color. Similarly, azo group has different color in one form and different another color in different form. Next is quinone. As we have discussed, benzene ring has different color. Benzoid form has different color, whereas quinone form has different color. Because of the presence of these groups, which contain lone pairs, or which contain unsaturation, or we can say which contains conjugated double bonds, indicators show different colors. They are capable of showing different colors on different pH values. Okay, so oxochrome, a little more, we will discuss little more about oxochrome. The name of oxochrome is derived from word oxo, that is an ancient Greek word which means to increase color. As I told you, oxochrome, they itself do not have any color, but when they get attached to chromophore, they change the color, or you can say the color, the intensity of the color increases. So oxo word means increase color. They itself do not have color, but they increase the color of the chromophoric group, at which it has been attached. they themselves fail to produce the color, but when present along with the chromophores in an organic molecule, they intensify the color. Okay, for example, we have hydroxyl group. All those groups which contain lone pairs are included in oxochromes, which are capable of using its lone pair of electrons in the conjugation, in the delocalization, are mainly come under oxochrome group. So hydroxyl group, it has lone pair of electrons, hence it acts as oxochrome, because it is capable of using its electrons for the delocalization. Similarly, amino group contains lone pair of electrons. It also acts as oxochrome. Aldehyde groups contains double bond. The pi bond, which is present in aldehyde, helps to enhance the color of the chromophoric group to which it has been attached. Next is methyl mercaptan. It is basically nothing but SCH3 group. Sulfur contains electrons. Because sulfur can donate its electrons, it is capable of using its electrons for delocalization, and hence it intensifies the color of chromophore. Oxochrome is a functional group of atom. It is a functional group of atoms with one or more lone pair of electrons. So this is what I was telling. Oxochrome is a functional group of atoms which contain lone pair of electrons, which when attached to the chromophore, it is going to alter the wavelength and intensity of absorption. For example, if earlier the intensity of chromophore was less, the color was not very dark, it was light. By the addition of oxochrome, we will observe that the color will become very intense. The intensity of the color will increase. Why the intensity of the color increases? Because the intensity of absorption have increased. If these groups are in direct conjugation with the pi system of the chromophore, they may increase the wavelength at which the light is absorbed, and as a result, the intensity of the absorption increases. So this is all about oxochromes. Oxochromes are nothing but they are the functional group of atoms which contain lone pair of electrons. They increase the wavelength and the intensity of absorption. Itself, they do not have any color, but when they get attached with the chromophore, the color of the absorption increases. Next topic is acid-base indicators at home. There are many fruits and vegetables which we use in our kitchen, which we consume, can be used also as an acid-base indicator. First indicator is beets. Now the color of the beet or the beet juice, it changes its color from red to purple when it comes in contact with the basic solution. So the beet juice can also be used as indicator because it changes its color with the change in the acidic and basic medium. Its color is red in the normal medium, but as it comes in contact with the basic solution, its color changes to purple. Similarly, cherries are red in color. They turn blue to purple when we add them in the basic solution. Similarly, curry powder changes its color from yellow to red in the basic medium. Red grapes, their color changes to violet in the basic solution. Onions give a very strong, onions also behave as a acid-base indicator, because they give characteristic smell in the basic solutions. They give a different kind of characteristic specific smell in the basic solutions. Also, the red color of onion changes to green in the basic solutions. The color of the onion also changes as the pH is varied, and the smell of the onion also changes as the medium becomes basic in nature. Rose petals can also be used as acid-base indicators. They turn their color to blue in the basic solution. Turmeric contains curcumin, which changes its color from yellow to red as the medium becomes basic. So the next topic is mixed indicators. Single indicators do not give sharp endpoint. There is a problem with the single indicators that they do not give sharp point, and the color change is not abrupt. Abrupt means it is the pH range is very wide. For example, if we consider ordinary acid-base indicators, the color change is not sharp. It means that it is not going to change the color very sharply. The color variation, the color changes usually observed at 2 units of pH. Okay, the color variation is observed at 2 units of pH. It is going to show the color change about, or we can say that the color change will not occur at a specific pH. The color change will extend over 2 units of pH. So this creates a problem. We do not come to know exactly where the equivalence point has been observed because the indicator has not given us sharp point. Because the indicator has not given us sharp point, so it creates a problem. So we use mixed indicator to overcome this problem. We use mixed indicators. The mixed indicators are very desirable because they give sharp color change over a narrow and selected range of pH. Ordinary indicators, they do not show sharp and abrupt change, whereas the mixed indicators, which are formed by the mixing of a few indicators, they give color change at a specific narrow and selected range of pH. They show abrupt change, and that too at a very, very specific and a narrow range of pH. How are mixed indicators prepared? This can be achieved by the mixture of indicators. For preparing mixed indicators, we use a mixture of indicators. The mixture of indicators are selected. The indicators whose mixture has to be prepared are selected in a manner that they should show the color variation at, you can, they should show a color color variation at a nearby pH. It should not be like that we are preparing a mixed indicator and we are using indicators which show transition, which show color variation at different pHs. For example, if we try to dissolve we try to prepare a mixed indicator by using two indicators who show color change at different pH, then it is not possible to prepare mixed indicators with those, whereas mixed indicators can be prepared only by those indicators which show color variation at almost, we can say that, overlapping pH values. Okay, so for the preparation of mixed indicators, we have to keep in our mind that the selection of indicators should be so that the particular pH range at which the indicator shows color should be same. It should be almost same. It should be close together. Only then mixed indicators can be prepared. So how can be mixed indicators prepared? This can be achieved by use of a mixture of indicators whose pK indication values are close together. They should be close to each other, and the overlapping colors are complementary at an intermediate pH. First of all, the selection of indicators should be in the manner that particular pH at which it shows transition should be close enough, and also they should produce overlapping colors so that the complementary colors can be achieved at that intermediate pH. Why are mixed indicators preferred over ordinary acid-base indicators? Because they give rise to extremely sharp color change. We can come to know about that particular sharp point at which the neutralization has taken place, or we can say we will come to know about a particular point at which the reaction has completed. Okay, with the ordinary acid-base indicators, this sharp point is not observed because they show they do not show the color change sharp at a sharp or abrupt. They do not show the color change abruptly. The color variation extends over 2 units, so we cannot use ordinary acid-base indicators in those cases. we use mixed indicators because they give us the color variation at a sharp pH, at a narrow pH interval. Whereas single indicators, they do not give sharp endpoint. Hence, always mixed indicators are preferred as compared to single indicators. So these are the two essential conditions, criteria, which must be fulfilled by the two individual indicators to be mixed. So while preparing mixed indicators, two essential criteria which must be fulfilled for to prepare and mixed indicator is, first of all, it must possess almost identical transition intervals. This is what we have covered in the previous slide. The first criteria is that the two indicators who are to be mixed should have identical transition intervals. They should show transition, they should absorb light, they should have a capability of absorbing light at particular pH range. Secondly, select these indicators in such a manner that the colors of the indicators should be complementary, and hence they can be the colors. Second point was that we should select the indicators in such a manner that their color, acid color, should combine to produce a color which represents the color obtained by the combination of their respective base colors. Okay, hence we can get a complementary color. The different features of the mixed indicators are, mixed indicators may be employed. What are the advantages of using mixed indicators is that mixed indicators may be employed for detecting the pH changes between the range 0.1 to 0.15. So mixed indicators can be employed for detecting the pH changes. The mixed indicators can be even effective for studying the pH changes when the range is from 0.1 to 0.15. Mixed indicators are therefore found to be quite easy because they give us very sharp, abrupt result, and hence they are found to be quite easy and convenient in a situation when the pH change on the titration curve is not large. Okay, when the pH change is not very large, we can use mixed indicators because mixed indicators are able to detect the pH change even at the range from 0.1 to 0.15. Third feature of mixed indicator is that when there is no distinct sharp pH change accomplished, the use of mixed indicator, we can use mixed indicator to carry out the reactions. For example, when we study weak acid titration with weak base, normally they do not have a distinct sharp pH change. In those cases, we will be discussing in the next lecture about different titrations, acid base titrations, strong acid base titrations, strong base titrations, weak acid, strong base titrations, and weak acid, weak base titrations. In the case of weak acid, weak base titration, there is no distinct sharp pH change. So in that case also, we can use mixed indicators because the normal, the ordinary indicators, they are not able to detect such a small change in the pH value. But with the help of mixed indicators, we can also detect the pH changes between the narrow range limit. So here are a few examples of mixed indicators. Bromocresol green and methyl orange. The mixture of these two indicators can be used. It gives a sharp endpoint. It gives a sharp, color change at pH 4.3. And the color changes from orange to bluish deep. Similarly, next mixed indicator is bromocresol green and chlorophenol red. The mixture of these two indicators gives a sharp endpoint at pH. We can observe the color variation at 6.1 pH, and the color changes from pale to green, bluish, violet. Next mixed indicator is neutral red and methylene blue. The mixture of these two indicators can be used to study the pH variation at pH 7, and the color changes from violet blue to green. Next is bromothymol blue and phenol red. It shows pH, sharp pH variation at 7.5, and the color changes from yellow to violet. Next is thymol blue and chrysol red. It is also used as a mixed indicator, and it gives us a sharp endpoint at pH 8.3, and the color changes from yellow to violet. So this was all about the mixed indicators. Mixed indicators, why are they used? Mixed indicators are used because ordinary acid-base indicators, they do not show us sharp or we can say abrupt color change, and it normally extends, the color change extends over 2 units of pH. So it was not desirable for us to study sharp color change over a narrow and selected range by using ordinary acid-base indicators. Whereas with the help of mixed indicators, we can study, we can detect pH change at a very narrow point also, at a narrow interval also. So these are the advantages of using mixed indicators. Because they work even when ordinary acid-base indicators fail to give sharp and abrupt endpoint. So hence mixed indicators are preferred instead of single indicators. So these were the two criteria which must be fulfilled by the individual indicators to be mixed. First was that they must possess almost identical transition intervals. So they must possess identical transition intervals. If the indicators which are to be mixed, they show transition at different intervals, then you cannot use them for preparation of mixed indicators. But if they have almost identical transition intervals, then they can be used for the preparation of mixed indicators. The second condition was, indicators should be selected in such a manner that the acid color should combine to produce a color or hue, that is a color or a tint which represents the hue which is observed produced by another indicator, and the combination of those indicators can be observed. And mixed indicators can be used for detecting the pH changes even between the range from 0.1 to 0.15, and hence even a sharp pH range can be detected by using mixed indicators. These were the few examples of mixed indicators, and the next one is universal indicators. Okay, the next one is universal indicators. Universal indicators are prepared. They help us to determine different pH of the solution. They are helpful at to determine the different pH of the mediums. For example, the universal indicator which is used in the laboratories, they show different colors at different pH. We can observe here that at pH 1, it shows red color. At pH 2, it shows pink color. At pH 3, it shows orange color. And so on, different colors are obtained at different pH. So these type of indicators is known as universal indicator. How are these universal indicators prepared? So by suitably mixing certain indicators, we mix certain indicators, okay, which produces changes in color over a considerable pH range. They show changes in color at a considerable pH range. Such mixtures are usually called universal indicators. Universal indicators are used by mixing different indicators which show changes at a considerable pH range. What is the composition of universal indicator? That is 0.1 gram phenolphthalein, 0.2 gram methyl red, 0.3 gram methyl yellow, 0.4 gram bromothymol blue, 0.5 gram thymol blue. All these indicators are mixed are prepared in ethanol, and sodium hydroxide is added in the mixture of these indicators till the color of the indicator is yellow. Till the yellow color is observed, these indicators zero, all these indicators are mixed in ethanol, and sodium hydroxide is added in the mixture so that the color of till that the color of the indicator is yellow. Okay, so we can see that different color changes which are observed at pH 2, the color observed is red. At pH 4, the color is orange. At pH 6, the color is yellow. At pH 8, the color is green. At pH 10, the color is blue. So we can see that as the pH is varying at different intervals, we get different colors. These types of indicators, that is they are known as universal indicators or multi-range indicators, are used most often in the labs because they help us to show the color variation. They show us color variation over a considerable pH range, unlike our normal acid-base indicators, which show us the color variation at a specific pH only. Universal indicators show different color. They show changes in the color over a considerable pH range. They are able to show the color variation. They are able to show the changes in the color over a considerable pH range. The universal indicator is collectively a mixture of indicators which show a color change in a solution. They show a color change which interprets how basic or acidic our solution is. For example, we use an universal indicator which is prepared by the combination of different indicators. It helps us to tell us that what is the specific pH, what is the specific pH of the solution at that particular point. A universal indicator can be used in a paper form, or it can also be used in the solution form. In the paper form, it is a strip of colored paper which changes color to red if the solution is acidic, and it changes its color to blue if the solution is basic. The strip, usually how we use it, we take a strip and we directly put it on the surface of the wet substance, or if it is not a wet substance, we prepare the solution of that particular substance and we put that on the paper. With the color changes, by the color change, we come to know what is the pH of the solution. Okay, and the next universal indicator is also used in the solution form. Okay, in the solution form, the main components are same thymol blue, methyl red, bromothymol blue, and phenolphthalein. The mixture is important because each component loses or gain. In all these, we will say because of the lose and gain of proton, because of the acid-base concept taking place, the color variation will be observed. It is beneficial to use this, the solution form. It is beneficial to use the solution form to use this type of universal indicator in a colorless solution. So it is more beneficial to use solution form of universal indicator when our medium is colorless, because a sharp or a very bright color change will be observed. This will increase the accuracy level of indication. When we have a colorless solution, a sharp color change will be observed, and this will increase the accuracy level of the indication. So this was all for today's lecture. In this lecture, we have studied acid-base titrations. In acid-base titrations, we have studied different indicators. What were the different theories given for different indicators? The first theory was Ostwald theory. Ostwald theory, according to Ostwald theory, the color change of the indicator was due to the ionization of acid-base indicator. Also, he was able to explain that a weak acid will not show a color in the acidic medium, whereas a weak base will not show a color in the basic medium. A weak indicator weak acid indicator will show a color variation at a basic medium only, and a weak basic indicator is capable of showing color variation at a acidic medium only. The drawbacks of the Ostwald theory was that it was not able to relate the color and the structure of the compound. He was not able to explain why different compounds give different color on the pH variation. All these problems were solved by next theory, which was Kuhn-Nord theory. According to Kuhn-Nord theory, the indicators, they exist in tautomeric forms. They have different structures. The two tautomeric forms, they have different electronic structures. Based upon the different electronic structures, they show different absorption of light and the complementary color is seen. So Kuhn-Nord theory was able to explain the different colors on the basis of the electronic structure.